Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this opportunity. First of all, I would like to thank the International Federation of Green Crescent regarding this great opportunity to get together here in this nice place with beautiful reasons and with clear visions and missions on how to fight these bad habits. I am Andri Tereka from Albania and Executive Director of Green Crescent Albania. I'm here together with Mr. Zavalani, Project Coordinator, and Mr. Gjinishi, Member of the Board in Albania. First of all, I would like to give a short presentation about Albania, the bright side of Albania, just to give you an idea where Albania is located. Albania is located right here. It is in the southeastern part of Europe, and in the north we have Montenegro, in the east we have Macedonia, south Greece, and just in the west we have Adriatic Sea. Now so this is Albania, as I told you, this is the map. Some information about Albania. We are in the Balkan Peninsula, as I told you, and the neighboring countries at the same time. And the area, we are 28,000 square meters, which is not that big. Just for the sake of comparison, I would like to compare it to Konya. Konya is the same, 28,000 square meters. Konya is a city in the middle of Turkey, I think, for those who do not know. So we have the climate and we have the geography features of Albania. These are some pictures taken. We have a beautiful country. And we have the Mediterranean and continental climate. This is, I named this the bright side of Albania. Now let's go to the other side of Albania, which is the very topic that we are discussing here. It is the addiction, it is the smoking, drug use, alcohol consumption, addiction, technological addiction. I have divided this presentation of mine into five parts. The first one is what is going on. This is a picture, a better picture to understand what is going on in Albania regarding the addiction and the consumption of substances which cause addiction. So the first part is an introduction of the situation. The second part is what shall be done, how to tackle this problem, and the third part is who should do it, who are the parties responsible to tackle these problems. The fourth one is how should we do it, because there might be many alternatives, ways on how to tackle these issues. And the last one are the challenges. The challenges that we are going to face regarding our mission. So, what's going on? In Albania, we have a progressive high level of alcohol, smoking, and drug consumption among youngsters. It is shocking to see that even in the elementary school, in the 8th and the 9th grade, we witness pupils smoking cigarette. The age of smoking has become so low that we have not imagined. Earlier on, we use this phenomenon was seen in the last years of high school. In the 80s. in the 80s, as we are told by our parents, those whose parents smoke maybe know this, that they started smoking when they were serving in the military service. Which is, this was the rule back then. But now, imagine, it is not the military service. It is not even the high school. It is the elementary school. But what is going on in the high school now? In the high school, we see now smoking and alcohol consumption. But what is going on in university? We have a very bad mixture. Alcohol consumption, smoking, and drugs. And it is going worse. I'm talking about Albania. We have, despite this very bad and very tragic picture, we do not have specialists to tackle this problem. There are several spontaneous, not related, not connected attempts to tackle this problem. But it is not enough. We have to get better organized. And we do not have centers to qualify these persons. It is not that we have centers and we have the capacity building to train and educate the specialists, and people want to get trained, but they don't know where to go. We don't even have those institutions. So we have to start from the scratch. We have some laws. They're very good, but they're not implemented. This is not the case only for Albania. It was not the case for the United States. It was not the case for Turkey. At the beginning, the law was not implemented fully, but gradually, with sufficient pressure done by both state and non-state actors, they reached at this point that where we are now. As Professor Cesar explained very well, in the United States, the fight against tobacco started back in the 50s. But then nobody cared about them. They were not considered, those who started to fight tobacco, they were not considered as an enemy. They were so few people believing that the smoking industry did not believe that these guys are going to cause big troubles to them. But thanks to these guys, in an effort of 50 years, now the tobacco industry have started thinking, look, these guys are damaging us. So, to cut it short, we have a long way to take in the future. At the same time, as I told you, the strong lobbying of tobacco. They are strong, they are everywhere, they have money, they can corrupt everyone. As long as you become a target of them, and as Professor Cesar mentioned, they will try every instrument, every way, every time, however, whatever it takes to get you. And at the same time, as we do not have rehabilitation clinics in Albania, which is that there were six, as I told you, there were spontaneous efforts to tackle the problem with drug addiction and smoking addiction, but they were not organized. Out of six clinics, rehabilitation clinics in Albania, we have now only one that survived. And the one that survived right now has become a center of methadone supplying. Methadone is a substitution substance for the drug addiction. And another clinic has become just a shelter. Just a shelter. Where people, and those who stay there, there are eight persons staying at that, those are drug addicts who do not have, who are homeless, do not have a shelter. So they're staying there mainly because of they do not have any other place to go, not because they are thinking that drug addiction is being really tackled by that rehabilitation clinic. On the other side, although there are some laws, it lacks a comprehensive legal framework to guarantee issues related to the abuses with substances in order to guarantee the protection of human rights, organization of continuous training for specific personnel, and the whole structure, service, and standards. We do not only have these things in place, but we also lack the legal framework. Do you find the picture a bit gloomy? It's normal. Okay. Now I'm giving you some data on consumption of alcohol and smoking. As you can see, more than 60% of Albanian males and 18% of females drink alcohol regularly. And 40% of the whole population drink alcohol on a daily basis. 20% of those youngsters from 15 to 25 years old are regular alcohol consumers. And 60% of the population smoke regularly. These data are taken from a survey conducted back in 2012, which means 5 years old. And believe me, the difference can be seen in daily life. It is getting worse. Death toll: 3,300 persons die every year in Albania because of the diseases caused by smoking. There was a survey, as Mr. Cesar mentioned in his presentation, that in the United States, when they calculated the cost of a packet of cigarette, adding also the expenses done by the healthcare institutions to heal the diseases caused by smoking, they found out that one package of cigarette really costs $28. That is the real cost. $28. It is not $2.8. It is not $4. So it is much higher. It costs not only financial, but the whole system. It causes the whole system to spend money on that package of cigarettes. And by 2030, this number will reach 7,500. We are talking about a very small country, just as big as Konya. Okay. Now, let's not forget this. The Albanians smoke off, they burn out every day $1.4 million. Only on smoking, which means $511 million per year, which is quite a lot. It is quite a lot, unfortunately. And regarding this, it's out of curiosity, 40% of students in medical schools are regular smokers. Why I am emphasizing this fact? Very soon, and the number is growing. Very soon we are going to lose the ability or the qualification to advise people on not to smoke and not to use drugs, because we will not have trustworthy and reliable doctors to tell patients or to tell other people that do not smoke, because they smoke themselves. They will not be reliable. This is the reason I included this in my presentation. This is from 2012. As you can see, the alcohol consumption by males according to their educational level. The reason why I included this is one example on how to read diagrams and what to find what to do to make out of them. As you can see, this is about males. The level of education does not play a big role in reducing the consumption, alcohol consumption. As you can see in the university, it is higher. The finding on this table is that the education level plays no role in reducing the consumption of alcohol. Why? Probably our education system is designed only to provide knowledge. This is my personal opinion now. I do not agree that an education system should provide only knowledge. Education system should provide also an alternative on how to live in a better way, and how to utilize the knowledge that students take from the schools. So know-how should be also included in the education system. But the diagrams shows that they tell us that education system does not have any influence in reducing the alcohol consumption. Now, this is the consumption of alcohol by male according to their residence. So we have every day, almost every day, 1 to 2 times a week, divided by urban and rural residential. As you can see, the dark blue is rural and the light one is urban areas. It is almost the same, almost the same. This is for the female. This is for the female. And we know that in rural areas are quite different from urban areas, starting from their social, cultural, and economic structures. But again, the consumption is the same. Why is that? I don't know. We know that the village is quite different from the city, but there is no difference in when it comes to alcohol consumption. I just want to go back one. Yeah, here. I think I missed this one. This is the alcohol consumption by females according to their educational level. As you can see, the higher the level, the more alcohol do the female consume. It comes to a level of 35% when you go to university. Why is that? Is it because they are away from home? Is it because they reach a certain independence? It is because the universities are located in cities? We don't know. But I think there is a, if there is no relation, there is a correlation. I think so, but we do not have mere scientific data about that. What shall be done? Increase the state and non-state capacities in fighting addiction in all levels. Establishment of a national treatment and care center for substances. As I told you, that we have none so far. Increase of knowledge, competences, and structures in the field of substance abuse. Establishment and strengthening of community services of substance users. Establish appropriate services for vulnerable groups. And establishment of addictive services in the punishment system. we do not have in the penitentiary centers. We don't have any facility to facilitate these phenomenon and social reintegration, which will come as a result of all the efforts that we do. We have to offer solutions. We have to offer solutions. Solutions should be short-term, mid-term, and long-term. We should never forget. But one thing to keep in our mind is that when we offer solutions, we should be able to identify the financial capacity of what we want to do. Because we might want to do very good things of very long-term effect, which might cost a lot. And if you do not have that money, it will discourage you. It will discourage you. And that's not a good thing. So first of all, you identify how much you have available and what you can do with that money. As I mentioned earlier, it's not only the state, it's not only the non-state actors, they're both. They should cooperate and find the best solutions, because we are all witnesses on how state has sometimes become a clumsy structure, hardly moving because of the bureaucracy. And we have non-state actors which are very fast, very effective, and very in touch with the society. But at the same time, we have, on the other side, we have experienced abuses by non-state actors which might get very easily corrupted. And it is the state actors which keep them under control. Green Crescent in Albania, one of the strategies that we have thought of is to establish a good relation with officials. And we are about to sign a cooperation agreement with these institutions, with the parliament, with the Ministry of Education, Health, Social Affairs, Interior. But believe me, the parliament is the most important one. Because despite of the pressure that you might put to the one of the ministries, to the Ministry of Education, Health, or Social Affairs, or Interior, they might say, okay, we want to do what you are asking us to, but the parliament will not pass it. So we have to be very strategic in our approach. Who decides about what we want to do? Who will propose it? And in our strategy, we should be comprehensive in our approach. We should not deal only with the parliament or with the ministry, but with both of them. We should also create the group of pressures to pressure decision makers, supporting and offering clear strategies to executive and local government. We cannot go to the local or central government and tell them, you know what, we should work together to fight smoking, to fight drug addiction. And they say, okay, very nice of you. What should we do? And they if you raise your shoulders and say, oh, we haven't thought of, no. You should go there with a clear strategy and a file in your hand with at least two or three alternatives on how to get them involved in your project. This is what we are going to do, what we are already doing in Albania. And long-term cooperation in different levels. The cooperation with Parliament and all institutions and signing the cooperation agreement with them is a long-term thing. Because although the minister might go, or the parliament is re-elected, or another term has started, you have an agreement in your hand. So the newcomers, they will have to obey to what you have signed with their previous officials. Yeah. The challenges on our work. The low state budget, as I mentioned earlier on, and other financial instruments. The law is very good. For example, we have a very good law in tobacco, but in smoking in closed areas, but it is not implemented. Why? I will tell you why. Because the directorate of tackling this problem, dealing with this issue in the Ministry of Health, is a directorate of three people. Three people. Three persons. It is so small. And the inspection and the inspection capacities and the inspection capacities are low as well. And also the time of cutting a fine to a restaurant because they allow, for example, people to smoke inside, it continues for 4 months. So you find them, and then you take the fine to the inspectorate, they verify it, they made it legal, official, and then another period of appeal starts, and the appeal, and then the ministry and the inspection has the right to appeal the appeal, and it goes on forever. And 75% of fined restaurants and or cafeterias, they keep on violating the law. 75% of those who got fined, they don't care. They continue violating the law. Another challenge is also the pressure and intrusion by tobacco, gambling, alcohol dealers, and not excluding drug dealers, not excluding them. There are small indicators in Albania that drug dealers of cannabis or cannabis sativa, they have made it to certain small political representatives, asking them to raise their voice in order to legalize cannabis sativa. They did it. They did it, unfortunately. They have lots of money. Now they have started to think very wisely that money is not enough. They should have also political power in order to have their trade going on. And the continuation of increasing drug trafficking. Albania, as you know, because of the geographical position, is in the crossroads of drug trafficking coming from Afghanistan, Turkey, going to Italy. So the exposure to the drug trafficking makes the fight a little bit fierce, more fierce. So this is almost everything I had to say. Thank you very much for your attention.